Okay, let's talk about something kind of creepy, or at least that creeps.
We've got bees.
We've got the Swarm Keeper. Tell me about the Swarm Keeper Ranger. I feel like this definitely fills a niche in many, many, many genres. Tell me all about this.
The Swarm Keeper, they feel a deep connection to the environment around them. And some rangers reach out through magical connections to the world and bond with a swarm of nature spirits. The swarm becomes a potent force in battle, as well as helpful company for the ranger. Some Swarm Keepers are outcasts or hermits, keeping to themselves and their attendant swarms rather than dealing with the discomfort of others. But other Swarm Keepers enjoy building vibrant communities that work for the mutual benefit of all those they consider part of their swarm. A Swarm Keeper's swarm and spells are reflections of the character's bond with nature spirits. And Tasha's Cauldron of Everything encourages you to take the opportunity to describe the swarm and the ranger's magic in play. For example, when your ranger casts gaseous form, they might appear to melt into the swarm instead of a cloud of mist, or the arcane eye spell could be an extension of your swarm that spies for you. Such descriptions don't change the effects of the spells, but they are an exciting opportunity to explore your character's narrative through their class abilities. And this ties into a section of Tasha's Cauldron called Personalizing Spells, which is, includes suggestions on how you can make your spells aesthetic fit your character's theming.
And I love these reminders, and again it reminds me of that really great gift that someone created, this art of someone with a sorcerer that uses a bow as their arcane focus and just showing them shoot like every spell as an arrow. I think that's brilliant, and I think that's like the classic, that's probably one of the best visualizations of just how far you can go with this. If you want to be the most powerful arcane archer in the world, just play a sorcerer who just uses a bow as an arcane focus. I like this reflavoring, and boy, is it hard not to play Batman with the Swarm Keeper in my mind. I love bats. I'm very tempted by this. A third level, we have the Gathered Swarm. So this is a third level ability. A swarm of intangible nature spirits has bonded itself to you and can assist you in battle. Until you die, the swarm remains in your space, crawling on you, flying, skittering around you in your space. You determine its appearance, or you can generate its appearance by rolling on the swarm appearance table. We've got swarming insects, miniature twig blights, which I adore this. This is, I don't know where this came from or who it came from. But we lost James, but we will hopefully get him back soon. Talking about how much I love the twig blights idea. The fact that there are these baby twig blights. I don't know who inserted this into this, but this is like just so, I mean, swarming insects, yes. Fluttering birds, yes. Playful pixies, sure.
I hope none of my players are watching this stream right now, because this has given me a terrible, awful idea. One of the main villains of my campaign is the vampire Golthias, who's responsible for the creation of the Blights. And having one of Golthias' lieutenants be a swarm keeper who uses these Blights as their swarm is... delightful. I will make that step lock ASAP now.
Now, I can see you playing a very creepy character. Like, of course, bats. I love bats. So if you want to be Batman, but better than Batman, this is a good subclass. But imagine if you chose grubs and you become a larva mage, basically. Yeah, I mean, you're like this otherworldly, you know, from space. Grub Ranger, like you come from the outer planes.
Todd!
I have won D&D! I turned something innocuous and hopeful into something horrifying.
Horrible.
I'm telling you, they crawl all over you. You're the Grub Ranger. I'm just saying, Larva Ranger. Ah. Larva Ranger is upsetting. Okay. So, moving on, I'm a terrible human being. Once on each of your turns, you can choose to to cause that swarm to assist you in one of the following ways immediately after you attack a creature. That the attack can do 1d6 piercing damage from the swarm. The attack target must make or succeed a strength saving throw against your spell DC or be moved by the swarm up to 15 feet horizontally in the direction of your choice. This gets a little weird on the battlefield. If you got a battle map, it could get real funny really fast, especially if you're like striking someone and they just go that way.
Mm-hmm. You're lifted up by the swarm and carried away.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Or you can be moved by the swarm up to 5 feet horizontally in any direction of your choice.
I have to say that I love abilities that move other creatures on the battlefield. Either like you're granting extra movement, like the Battlemaster does, or you're forcing people to move, like the Swarm Keeper or the Warlock with some of their invocations can do. And I know this is one, relatively grid map dependent, and two, adds a little bit of extra complexity to the table in a way that we saw quite starkly in fourth edition, where every second ability had a push or a pull or something on each other, just bouncing around like a pinball. But man, I love that stuff. I love it because of it lets you make use of environmental hazards like spike pits and lava pools, acid pools, rip AFL, moreover, creates this sort of dynamic environment where if you watch, say, The Princess Bride, the fight between Inigo and Mast Wesley at the very beginning of the film, they have this big arena. And there are two swordsmen who in D&D could very well just kind of be locked in combat in the same 2 5-foot squares, but they're dancing around, they're bouncing all around the map as they make use of the terrain in exciting ways. And that's the sort of cinematic combat that I really get excited for.
Especially in tight quarters, when we're looking at, say, a dungeon, or if you're in a graveyard, you know, I did run my wife on a game where she was playing a wildfire druid, and it became very apparent if you send like 100 zombies at somebody, where you are on the battlefield matters a great deal, especially once you have everything on the battle map and you've aligned it. This can be a game changer. This can save lives.
Yeah.
You know, this can really slow the enemy down, and you become this very strategic ranger, and that makes it exceptionally fun. Especially if it's grubs. Imagine grubs or larva moving you 15 feet. Do you get over that? I don't think so.
Transferred to a different show ever. can you get me off Tauntauns?
All right, Cuzfee. Don't worry. You'll lose the internet anyway soon.
All right, the show must go on.
Swarmkeeper magic. Run me through this.
Swarmkeeper magic. Another third level feature for you.
Marzipan.
Oh, little Marzi is desperate for attention. Here, come on up here. Just like the Fey Wanderer Ranger who gets some extra spells. The Swarmkeeper gets Swarmkeeper magic as well. You want to go? First of all, you learn the Mage Hand cantrip, if you don't already know it, which takes the form of your swarming nature spirits. I would love to pick a lock using my swarm of bees.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Just get proficiency in thieves' tools and let the bees do the rest.
Also,
you learn new spells when you reach certain levels. First of all, being Fairy Fire and Mage Hand at third level, Web at fifth level, Gaseous Form at ninth, Arcane Eye at 13th, and Insect Plague at 17th. Now, Insect Plague and Web already fit the sort of swarmy, insect-y theme that the Swarmkeeper Ranger has going for it. But just like we talked about at the very beginning of this, reflavoring the spells is one of the core components of the Swarmkeeper. Fairy Fire may not be, you know, spectral flames like it usually is, but it might be the shimmering iridescent pattern of a swarm of beetles that has appeared around the enemy, or you know, even just a flock of sparrows that you have thrown in their direction swarming about them,
or fireflies.
And so it's up to you to think about what sort of cool flavor you want to impart to your character. One of my favorite parts of D&D, absolutely.
Yeah, I think this is a very fun and on the point type of thing. And when they mention that you can reflavor this, That means, like, if you chose bats, because you should, or grubs, the insect plague could be bats.
Yeah.
You know, you could reflavor it that this is a bat swarm, because specifically that's what it calls out. So don't forget that. I'm concerned, though, if you choose bats, what web is made of. I don't know that. Yeah, lots of guano. Let's just things get real gross and sticky. We've seen that National Geographic special. So moving on, let's talk about the writhing tide. You can condense part of your swarm into a focus mass that lifts you up. As a bonus action, you gain a flying speed of 10 feet and can hover. This effect lasts for 1 minute or until you are incapacitated. You can use this feature a number of times equal to your proficiency bonus and regain all expended uses when you finish a long rest. This is great. Hey, who doesn't like to fly? 10 feet's a little slow. Hovering's really good. Especially if you're an archer.
Yeah, so it's less of a quick escape feature and more of a ambush preparation feature, or even just like an exploration feature.
Yeah,
which fits within the ranger theming perfectly. You may not be able to dart at 60 feet per round away from a rampaging ogre, but you certainly can slowly scale a cliff without needing to climb.
Absolutely. And if you look like hazardous stuff, I mean, you know, lava is lava, and you can probably just like move across that field or hover across a river or any kind or a trap of any kind. Yeah. So
carry your allies with you, that sort of thing.
Yeah. Can you do it to anyone else, though? I think it's just you.
You gain a flying speed, so
yeah, you yourself
have the carrying capacity to do it. Then
that's true. That's accurate. All right, tell me about Mighty Swarm.
Mighty Swarm, the 11th level feature. Your gathered swarm, which is, you know, the swarm that you get from your third level feature, grows mightier in the following ways. First of all, their damage increases to 1d8. Nice. If the creature fails its saving throw against being moved by the gathered swarm, which let's remind everyone is already 15 feet in any direction horizontally, you can also cause the swarm to knock the creature prone. Very good. All melee attacks against him have advantage. But you also don't have to, because if you're fighting at range, being prone puts range attacks at disadvantage. You may not want to do that. So
yeah,
you don't have to. And finally, when you are moved by the gathered swarm, it also gives you half cover until the start of your next turn.
Very good. And that is like a what? That's a +2 to your AC and your dexterity saving throws?
Exactly right.
Yep. You suddenly become kind of a tougher ranger. And then, yeah, you are quite good at just moving around the battlefield, knocking people down, getting back up. You're definitely the most, you're not a teleporter, but you're almost the opposite of the Fey Ranger, and the fact that like you're not disappearing and appearing in different places as much as you just can go wherever you want to.
Honestly, quite fond of the mix of exploration and combat abilities that the Swarm Keeper has.
Yeah.
Many Rangers kind of lean too far one way or the other just because the base class is so exploration focused. So like the Hunter is basically all combat all the time. But this has a very nice flavorful balance that I'm quite fond of. I would play a Swarm Keeper in a heartbeat.
Now, I believe there's like a summon. What's summon beast, correct, for the ranger now in Tasha's?
Yes.
And one of those options are a flying beast, correct?
Let me double check, but I think you're right.
So you could envision whatever it is that you are summoning is a dire form of your swarm, which would be fun. Indeed. Yes, so you can imagine you are summoning, you know, a giant bat, you know, a giant firefly, or a giant grub.
Yeah. So now the summon beast spell, I see what you're doing, Todd. Now the summon beast spell does, it creates a small beast. So it's about the size of a halfling or a goblin. So you're not summoning a bat with a 12-foot wingspan, but do imagine what would happen if you scaled a bee up to the size of a human child.
I don't want that. That flies in the house. I leave. I
don't want to see that anywhere.
Or a grub. So tell me about. Wait. You took the last one, I believe, correct? Yeah, so swarming dispersal. This is your capstone. It's 15th level. I'm so sorry, everyone at home. I am a terrible person. You can discorporate into your swarm now to avoid danger. When you take damage, you can use your reaction to give yourself resistance to that damage. That's any damage. Mm-hmm. You vanish into your swarm and then teleport to an unoccupied space that you can see within 30 feet, where you reappear with your swarm. You can use this feature a number of times, you guessed it, equal to your proficiency bonus, and you regain all expended uses once you finish a long rest. You're a tough ranger now.
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of are your swarm, and you can kind of make the argument that, you know, I mean, this becomes kind of interesting. Where does the swarm end and you begin?
Mm-hmm.
Were you always a pile of bats all along? You know,
I can see the Swarm Keeper Ranger being a cultist of the Elder Evil Caius, the Worm That Walks.
Oh, ooh, now we're going right now. I've converted you.
Yeah, I'm leaning into the grubs now, Todd Kenrick.
Yeah, I corrupt everyone.
There was an adventure path for D&D 3rd edition called Age of Worms. I mentioned Dan Dillon a lot this episode, but that's a favorite of his, if I recall correctly. Where your adventurers are pitted against an elder evil called Caius, the Worm That Walks, a demigod of terrible power who takes the form of a giant humanoid in a deep, voluminous robe, but their entire form is made up of writhing worms and maggots. And Caius is trying to take over the world and summon the Age of Worms, but it's a very classic high fantasy adventure with a somewhat otherworldly, disgusting, wormy twist. And I think having a villain who could be a disciple and adherent of Caius's wormy ways would be a very fun use for this ranger.
There's interesting ways to flavor this ranger as well. I could see a Warforged using almost like nanites.
Ooh,
right? Or even better, little tiny action figure sized versions of Warforged that are with you and they all Voltron up to form you, you know, and you had this 15th level ability.
Cool.
But if you want that more sci-fi bent, I could see something like that. I always like the twig blights. I think that's adorable. Mm-hmm. Even though the blights are like a nightmare. They are one of my favorite low level enemies actually in D&D. I everyone loves a good zombie, but blights have a little bit of that creepy tree that's coming for you. Mm. And needle blights are just, I'm like afraid of them in real life and they're not even real. So that's what I'll say about that. So that's the Swarm Keeper Ranger. I really like this. I think this is a very functional ranger.
All of my thoughts immediately trend towards villain because we as a society have this sort of, I feel like prejudice against swarming creatures. They're scary. But
almost instinctual, in fact.
You know, that's a fair point. You see a swarm of insects gunning for you and you're like, I'm not sticking around to see if they're friendly. But I think there are some heroic applications to this as well. I could see very much sort of a Snow White and the Huntsman sort of gritty Disney princess who conjures swarms of woodland beings to fight for them.
Tiny little pixies that are almost like the size of Tinkerbell. They're just like lights that attack and assist you. So, because they do say these are basically spirits of the Feywild or the forest that you are summoning, and they take this form that you've kind of determined. So I feel that's fair. I mean, yeah, you can definitely you can go dark with it if you want to, but
yeah, calling them spirit creatures rather than literal creatures is a nice way to sidestep the question of where are all these guys coming from. Like if you're in the middle of a desert and you're a forest ranger, where are you finding your swarm of sparrows? And it's answering, well, they're nature spirits who follow me. But I think if that's not your cup of tea, it's the easiest thing in the world to just sort of say that you have a little menagerie of birds or bees or spiders or blights or whatsoever you want that just kind of stay with you.
Absolutely. And let's go ahead and we've got some questions. Mm-hmm. We've got questions. Let's see. Questions about the Swarm Keeper. We've got a question for the Swarm Keeper. Would effects such as enlarge and reduce or giant insect or insect plague have any overlap? Not really. I mean, just sure in terms of flavor. Understand
the question.
Yeah, I mean, not with any of your particular effects. Mm-hmm. So I think this is more of a flavor issue than anything else.
They're very flavorful, and I'd recommend you take spells like that if you want to lean into the buggy nature of the Swarmkeeper. But you know, they won't.
The buggy nature of Swarmkeeper. Wow.
they will be a part of your swarm. Yeah.
Does Gathering Swarm provoke an opportunity attack? I would say that it does. If you move someone, it does not. So that's that, because that gets very abusive very quickly. If you're moving someone 15 feet, I don't believe that provokes an opportunity attack. And if you move yourself, it would.
So that's an interesting question. The wording of this intrigues me because forced movement does not provoke opportunity attacks ever. So if you move an enemy with your swarm, your party can't just like leap on them and take opportunity attacks, they lose. So that's right out. But the way that this feature is worded, you are moved by the swarm 5 feet horizontally in direction of your choice. I would rule that you do not provoke opportunity attacks because of this, because you are not moving, the swarm is moving you.
Mm-hmm.
I certainly can see a player who is deep in rules knowledge explaining that to me, and I would be like, yeah, you're absolutely right. You're not moving. And something about the fact that it's 5 feet horizontally makes me think about the 5 foot step of third edition or the shift of fourth edition, which is just a little bit of a pop out of an enemy's threatened range so that you don't have to worry about provoking an opportunity attack.
It's an interesting thing that would be fun for you and I to play test sometime, actually. Mm. I think I don't know if you have the obsession with subclasses quite that I do, but like I love to see them in battle and see what happens and occurs. I think that's
kind of... Few people love subclasses in quite the way you do, Todd, but they are very fun.
They are narrative hooks to me. So yeah. They drive me, you know, for someone who DMs far more than they ever have played, they do evoke a lot of ideas.
Hell yeah.
Question. What kind of swarm would a sea elf have? Sea bass?
Anchovies.
You know, jellyfish stinging, first off, makes a lot of sense.
Nasty.
Yeah. And especially if you make the jellyfish both they obviously can exist both outside of water and inside of water. I think that makes a lot of sense. Hermit crabs. Poof.
I just looked up smallest shark. I just Googled smallest shark. The smallest shark, the dwarf lantern shark, is smaller than a human hand. It's rarely seen and little is known about it. It's only been observed a few times off the northern tip of South America.
Wow.
Summon the smallest shark in the world. Your little hand-sized swarm of sharks.
Yep, that's scary enough. I don't like that at all. Yeah. I think that works quite, you know, floating sea urchins would be interesting. So question, in previous subclass releases, most limited use abilities were tied to a relevant stat, such as wisdom for the ranger or a flat number, two for the bladesinger and the arcane archer. In Tasha's, the design was shifted to proficiency bonus. What are your thoughts on this final question? I believe the bladesinger was moved to proficiency bonus, correct? Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say no to that happening, and we already talked about this happening to the Arcane Archer eventually. For those that complain about that, the Arcane Archer does get that stuff back on a short rest, which is pretty quick. You know, that's 10 minutes and you're back in the game. But I feel like the proficiency bonus is perhaps a more elegant and scalable solution.
I liked proficiency bonus scaling a lot. It takes some of the pressure off of maximizing your core ability score, which means that you can be a little bit more suboptimal, I suppose, with your ability score choices. I have an interesting perspective on this issue because I have been an editor for a lot of third-party products in the past. And one of the things that third-party freelance writers often try to do, 3, 4, 5 years ago, was link things to proficiency bonus. And I had to constantly red pen that because it's not something that Wizards of the Coast did. It doesn't fit with established 5e design. So what that says to me is that it's something that people wanted and were constantly thinking about, but was limited by the fact that it hadn't been done in official capacity. So seeing it done officially, it makes me very happy because it seems like a common sense solution.
Yeah, I agree. I overall, I really like these Rangers. I'm a little bit more obsessed with the Swarm Keeper Ranger because I do like the movement back and forth. And you know, if I'm obsessed with any swarm, it's bats. I love bats. Like, it's ridiculous. I remember seeing my first bat as a little kid, and I was blown away that this thing was just all stomach and teeth, and that's it. And then I met a fruit bat in college, and it was the most adorable little thing. It was as smart as a dog, and it could lick its own eyes, and was so friendly, and had to wiggle its butt. So bats are the best thing. I think there's lots of like fun ways to flavor both of these, and that's our take on the Rangers as you find them in Tasha's. We may do another video specifically about the changes to the Ranger in terms of the options, but we don't have time for that. We are at the end of our Todd Talks. Thank you so much, James Hake, our lead writer over at D&D Beyond, the author of many a D&D book. He's also got some fantastic products on DM's Guild as well, and just a great friend in general. Thank you so much for watching, James. Thank you for being on the show.
Thanks for having me. Until next time.
Bye.
Tasha's Cauldron of Everything is available now on D&D Beyond. Purchase before January 5th to unlock the Cauldron dice set, as well as character sheet backdrops, themes, and frames.